Instead of ruined sinners, hangs the Pour out our praise to you, oh. Well, good morning. Allow me to extend a very warm welcome to you, wherever it is that you're watching us from, to this 18th digital Oldfield Park Baptist Church service. My name is Paul, and I'm the community outreach worker at Oldfield Park Baptist Church. And just as we start this morning, I just thought that we would take a moment to open our service in prayer. And as I was thinking and preparing the sermon for this week, we're going to be thinking on the topic of what it means to be a holy community. And as I was thinking about that, I realized that actually the only reason that we get to be called a holy community is because of all of the work that Jesus has done. And indeed, the very reason that we meet together to worship is because of everything that Jesus achieved. This whole thing, this church thing that we do, it's actually not really about us, or it shouldn't be. It should be all about the person who gave his life to establish people holy, set apart for God. And so as we start, as we open in prayer, I thought it would be good to just reflect on a prayer that Jesus made for us, his people. And so I'd just like to read a little chunk from John 17. It's a prayer that Jesus makes, all about those who are going to believe in him. So I'll just read it because that includes us, doesn't it? So I'll just read it. John 17, it says, Jesus says, "I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one, I in them and you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. Father, I want those you have given me to be with me where I am and to see my glory, the glory you have given me because you loved me before the creation of the world. Righteous Father, though the world does not know you, I know you, and they know that you have sent me. I have made you known to them and will continue to make you known in order that the love you have for me may be in them and that I myself may be in them." They are wonderful words of Jesus, those words that promise an intimate relationship with us and a glory that is not our own, that is given to us by God through Jesus. And so as we start today, as we think about what it means to be this holy community, we should start by praying that this prayer of Jesus would be answered. And so join me in prayer as we start. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for Jesus, for the cross and the resurrection. Thank you that we are brought together as your people, a holy people called by you through Jesus. Thank you that this holiness and this glory and this hope that we have is not through anything that we have done, but it's entirely through your work and your working through Jesus. Lord, we pray that our hope would always be in him, not on anything that we could do. And we ask that you would help us, as Jesus prayed here, that you would help us to be united in our hope and that we would be brought together in unity, even as we are separated through this lockdown at this time. We pray that we would be unified in our love for you and in our love for each other. We ask it in Jesus' name, for your glory's sake, Lord. Amen.
Up to the hill of Calvary, my Saviour went courageously, and there he bled and died for me. Hallelujah for the cross. And on that day the world was changed, a final perfect lamb was slain. Let earth and heaven now proclaim, hallelujah for the cross. Hallelujah for the war he fought, love Saviour made a way. Hallelujah for the cross. A slave to sin, my life was bound, that all my dreams fell to the ground. When Jesus' blood came flowing down, hallelujah for the cross. Hallelujah for the war he fought, love has won, death has lost. Hallelujah for the souls he bought, hallelujah for the cross. And when I breathe my final breath, I'll have no need to fear at rest. This hope will guide me into death, hallelujah for the cross. Hallelujah for the war he fought, love has won, death has lost. Hallelujah for the souls he bought, hallelujah for the cross. Hallelujah for the war he fought, love has won, death has lost. Souls he bought, hallelujah for the cross, hallelujah for the cross, hallelujah for the
chasm that lay between us.
How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness your loving kindness shot through the shadows of my home. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living home. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living home. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living home.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began silence, the roaring lion, declare the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, sin has lost its grip on me. The one who set me free, hallelujah. Sin has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Let us pray. Lord Father God, I want to thank you for the amazing work that our frontline workers and key workers continue to do to keep us safe. For as it says in 1 Corinthians 10, verse 24, no one should seek their own good, but the good of others, which I think reflects what has been seen by the amazing sacrifices people to keep others safe. Lord God, I also continue to pray for us as a church family, that we are kept safe, we are kept healthy, and that one day we may reunite in our building in Oldfield Park. We can hug each other, we can declare our love for you as one whole unit, rather than a separate in our own homes. Lord God, I also pray a thanks for the internet. At times it can be frustrating when it won't connect, but when it does, it is amazing to be used so that we can keep in contact with our friends, with our families, and with our loved ones who are far away. Lord God, I also pray a protection for our world. At this time, Lord, it is so uncertain about the future or about what may come or what may happen. All of that is in your hands. And we thank you that you know every part of our lives, that you know each of us as human beings innately, that you were with us from the start and you will be with us till the end. We thank you that you are constant. We thank you that you are loving. We thank you that you are there when we need you. You may not answer our prayers immediately, Lord, but we know that you are there. You have your hand on our shoulders. You lift us up above and out of all confusion. You are our strength. And you have kept us going throughout this whole crisis. And for that, God, we are eternally grateful. We exalt you. We lift you. Pray a blessing over us all for the coming weeks. I ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Make every key. he hath done. So loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who yielded his life an atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he has done. Of blood to every believer, the promise of God. The vilest offender who truly believes that moment from Jesus a pardon receives. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, Father, through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he has done. Great things he has taught us, great things he has done, and greater rejoicing through Jesus the Son. But purer and higher and greater will be a wonder of worship when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he has done.
Today's reading is from 1 Peter 1, verses 13 to 2, verse 3. Therefore, with minds that are alert and fully sober, set your hope on the grace to be brought to you when Jesus Christ is revealed at its coming. As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance. But just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, be holy because I am holy. Since you call on the Father who judges each person's work impartially, live out your time as foreigners here in reverent fear. For you know that it is not with perishable things, such as silver or gold, that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your ancestors, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. He was chosen before the creation of the world, but revealed him in the last of these times for your sake. Through him, you believe in God, who raised him from the dead and glorified him, so your faith and your hope are in God. Now that you have purified yourselves by obeying the truth, so that you have sincere love for each other, love one another deeply from the heart, for you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living and enduring word of God. All people are like grass, and their glory is like the flowers of the field. The grass withers and the flowers fall, but the word of the Lord endures forever. And that is the word that was preached to you. Therefore, rid yourselves of all malice and deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and slander of every kind. Like newborn babies, crave pure spiritual milk, so that you may grow up in your salvation, now that you have tasted that the Lord is good.
Bring the presence of the risen Lord.
My name is Paul and I'm the community outreach worker here at Oldfield Park Baptist Church. Allow me to repeat my welcome to you this morning. If you are new, if you've just stumbled across this video, then you are very welcome and I do hope that you'll be blessed this morning. We're going to be looking today at the next chunk of the book of 1 Peter, and so feel free to find that in your Bible or in your Bible app. I'll pray and then we'll begin. So let's pray. Dear God, thank you for your word. Please be at work in us this morning by your Holy Spirit to hear what you have to say and prepare our hearts to be ready to change, to follow you in Jesus' name. Amen. So the last time that I preached, we began a short side series looking through the letter of 1 Peter. From the angle of what the gospel means for us as a community. And we looked at how we are a community of a living hope, that when everything is stripped away from us, as it has been during this pandemic, all of our activities, all of our secondary focuses, when they're all gone from us, really the thing that brings us together as a community, that focus of what it means to be church, is the gospel, which Peter calls this living hope. The death and resurrection of Jesus from the dead. Now, this week, we're going to be looking at the next section in 1 Peter and thinking about how the gospel should shape our community. And here, Peter's key focus, the key thing that he wants to encourage all of his readers, which includes us, what he wants to encourage us all as believers is to be holy. Okay, and you can see that really clearly in verses 15 and 16. Peter's key point, he says, just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all that you do. For it is written, be holy because I am holy. And so this morning, I want to take the time just to look at this. First of all, I want us to think about what holiness actually is. And then I want us to see about how that applies to us today. So first of all, what is holiness? OK, because it's a word that doesn't get used a lot by many people. And so understandably, it's widely misunderstood. OK, so for many today, it tends to conjure images of ancient buildings, priests, rituals, traditions, mystical artifacts, basically a lot of outward pomp and ceremony. And whilst there is an aspect of that to it, it kind of misses the point. Holiness has to do primarily with the relationship that something has with God. Holiness has to do primarily with the relationship that something has with God. Now, God is perfect and pure and good. Nothing impure or imperfect could ever come into contact with him. It would be consumed and destroyed by his perfection. So for something or someone to come into God's presence, it would first need preparing. It would need to be set apart from common use. It needs purifying. And that's the first part of what it means for something to be made holy. It means being purified and set apart. And that means going through a process to be prepared for this relationship. So imagine a hospital operating theatre. Okay, an operating theatre is purified and set apart in order to make it safe for a person to be operated on. Okay, every surface is cleaned to an incredible degree. The instruments that are used are sterilised. The surgical team are scrubbed and gowned and masked and gloved. Even the air is ventilated a set number of times per hour to keep it clean. And all of this is done to protect the patient from infection and complication so that a skilled surgeon can operate and save their life. Well, in the same way that preparing a theatre for surgery requires a lot of work. In the Old Testament, to make something holy was no easy task, right? It required, initially, it would require making a sacrifice, often a blood sacrifice of some animal, just simply in order to initially dedicate it. But then after that, there would be a perpetual series of washing and ritual to maintain its purity. Allow me to encourage you to read through the book of Leviticus later. It is a really tough read because there's a lot of repetition and a lot of intricate detail in there. But that book is all about Moses opening up to God's people about what it takes to make the tabernacle and ultimately the temple holy space, a place where God's presence could meet. So trust me, it's a lengthy and laborious process, but well worth the read. And once all this was done, even after that, there were strict rules to follow. So objects had to specific guidelines for how they could be handled, if they could be handled at all. And on top of that, how they needed to be stored and carried and covered and placed. I mean, if you think that social distancing measures come with a lot of details to remember, they ain't got nothing on Levitical holiness laws. The point of all of them, though, was this. Because God is perfect and pure, then ordinary things that are by nature not perfect and pure, they can't come into his presence. They need to be purified and they need to be set apart. They need to be made holy before they can come into his presence. Now, the point and the purpose of going through all of this rigmarole was because through their use, if everything was kept holy, it would give the people the chance to meet with God, to engage in a relationship with God as his people, to be in communication with him and to serve him. And in return, the people would receive his blessing and his presence with them. And that is an endeavour that is worth taking up, because there is nothing more precious in all the world than being in relationship with the perfect and pure creator of the universe. And so to be holy means to be purified, to be set apart, and to be made ready for a specific purpose for God's use. So now that we've got this kind of working definition of what holiness is, let's come back to the fact that actually Peter calls us to be holy. He calls the church to be holy. So Peter calls us to be holy just as the one who has called us is holy. We are called to be purified, set apart for God's purposes. So what does that mean? What would that look like for us today in Oldfield Park? Well, firstly, it means that we have a holy status. We have a holy status. Now, I hope you heard, as the passage was read this morning, how certain and definite our holy status is. Our holiness is something that we are, that was secured for us in the past by Jesus. Okay, I'm just going to skim very quickly through some bits in verses 17 to 21. And as I do that, just listen to how Peter is describing our current status, our holy status. Verse 17, he says, you call on a father. Not that you will call, but you call on a father. Verse 18, you know that you were redeemed. Verse 20, he, that's Jesus, was revealed to you in these last times for your sake. Verse 21, through him, you actively believe, you do believe. Verse 22, now that you have purified yourselves. So all of the verbs there, the active, all of the tenses are in the past. Peter is saying here, we are holy. It's not something that's going to happen, that we can circle a date in the future. No, it is the current reality that we experience. And this truth that our status is holy it's really important for us to bear in mind, because I don't know about you, but I often feel like I pendulum between a constant feeling of failure on the one extreme to feeling like I'm contributing to my holiness in the other. Okay, and really, both extremes are pretty ridiculous when you think about it. Because on the one hand, how on earth could we be failing if our holiness doesn't depend on us? Because Peter is not saying live perfect lives to earn holiness. Now, what he's saying is that you have been made holy through the living hope of Jesus. Everything has been done that needed to change your status from being ignoble to being ultimately precious, to being a priceless thing and able to come even into God's presence. You are holy. It's been done for you. Think back to that operating theatre, all right? Those, the instruments, the surgical instruments that lie underneath a protective sheet, once they've gone through that process to become sterilised and hygienic, they don't need to undergo any further preparation. They are fully fit to be taken and used by the surgeon. And in the same way, we are holy. We have been purified and set apart. It's been done for us, and we are entirely ready through Christ to be useful to God. So that's the one extreme, but that makes the other extreme ridiculous too, because how could we contribute anything to our holiness if it's all been done for us? We simply can't. It's entirely a gift from God. And verse 21 sums it up just perfectly, okay? Because Peter reminds us that through him, that's Jesus, through him, you believe in God who raised him from the dead and glorified him. And so your faith and hope are in God. See, the scalpel contributes nothing to the process of being sterilized. The process happens to it. And in the same way, our faith is a gift, a complete and total gift, so that none of us can boast. So there's that tension, okay? We mustn't boast, because our holy status is something that's been done for us entirely by God through Christ. But then, we must also stand secure in our holy status, because it has been secured by God and is not dependent on us being perfect. So we've heard that we have this new status, this holy status, and we can trust that we have it because God says that we have it. But what's the point of having it? What's it for? Well, as I said before, anything that went through the process of being purified and made holy in the Old Testament had the purpose of helping us understand God's perfect nature and to bring people into relationship with him, for allowing sinful mankind a way of drawing near to a perfect and pure and good God. Well, the church is also called to have this holy purpose. As we live out our holiness through this living hope in Jesus, we're actually called to reflect to the world the perfect, pure and good nature of God, and to show others how to come into relationship with him. We have a very clear and obvious function on how to carry out this holy purpose. Now, I think it's evident to everyone who knows me that I have no medical training or knowledge whatsoever. Please don't cut your finger near me, because I will only make it worse. And heaven forbid you should choke, because I'm not going to be any help in that situation. But even I, when I look at a scalpel, could probably hazard a good guess as to what it's for. I mean, it's clearly an instrument that involves precision cutting. It's got a very small, extremely sharp blade. It's got a delicate handle that's just about the right size for a hand. It looks like it's made for its function. And so we as the church should demonstrate our function, our holy purpose, clearly. Peter spells it out for us really clearly in verses 22. Now that you have purified yourselves by obeying the truth, so that you have sincere love for each other, love one another deeply from the heart. When we obey the truth of the gospel, responding to that truth of how deeply God loves us, and then when we respond by beginning to love other believers who share this love of God, it becomes obvious that our function and our purpose for being made holy, our holy purpose, is to love one another. Let me say that again. Our holy purpose is to love one another. That is the ultimate purpose of being made holy through our faith in Christ, that we would love one another in a way that reflects God's goodness and purity and perfection out into the world. There is a tension, though, because we can either think that that is way too easy or way too hard. See, some of us might think that it just seems a little bit easy, a little bit weak, a little bit flimsy, all about warm, fuzzy feelings. For some of us, you know, maybe we feel that actually the church should be something more harder, that should be all about mission or about changing the world or about social action in the immediate area or about fighting for some cause, whatever that is. But actually here in verse 22, we are called to love each other, and that's our primary purpose, our holy purpose. For sure, those other things are important and they will naturally bear out as we live out our living faith. But it comes after our loving each other and other believers sincerely from the heart. And let me assure you, if you think it's too easy, it is far from easy to love other believers sincerely from the heart. I mean, have you met us? We are all self-confessed sinners. We are all broken people in deep need of God's grace for every moment of our lives. But the flip side can be that for some of us, we find this call just too hard of a task, you know, too much of a pressure. So maybe you've been a bit bruised by other believers in the past who you've tried to love and you have sincerely given your all to love, who have just thrown it back in your face and hurt you. Maybe that's still ongoing. Or maybe you have felt unloved by other Christians in churches from your past, and that has understandably made you want to put up barriers to stop yourself from being hurt again. It's often difficult because as broken sinners living lives that are often broken in subtle ways, this call to love one another sincerely is often messy, and it will be hard sometimes, and it will require a lot of sacrifice from us and more than a little bit of bravery in order to share other people's lives and to allow them to share our lives. But thankfully, Peter reminds us of a great truth that can really spur us on to undertaking this task. The truth is that this holy purpose that we have has an enduring and eternal quality to it. You see, this call to love one another is not some isolated call to action. No, Peter reminds us constantly that this purpose and this holiness has been brought about by our living hope in Jesus. And this hope is eternal. Look how he puts it in verse 23. He says, "For you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable through the living and enduring word of God." See, whatever we think about this call to love one another, whether we see it as too easy or too hard, if we have eternity in perspective, that makes it easier. If our loving one another will have eternal consequences, it will encourage us to suffer the disappointments we fear. Because even if the person we're aiming to love doesn't respond the way we want them to, there is an eternal consequence, an endurability about it that goes on forever. It can make us brave in that respect. Or if we think that our loving one another, it will be too easy, well, having eternal consequences increases its value exponentially, puts it right up there with mission and public reform or social action. We've heard that we have a holy status, and we have heard that we have a holy purpose. But what will it look like to be a holy community? How should we love one another sincerely? How can we be a holy community? Well, look with me at chapter 2, verse 1. Peter says, "Therefore, rid yourself of all malice and all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and slander of every kind." Here is a concrete, set in stone plan to start with, whether you're from the first century or the 21st century. Here is a great place to really get our teeth into. See, each of these attributes, malice, deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and slander, all of these have a commonality within them, which is that the person who practices them breaks down the unity amongst believers in order to try and privilege themselves. Okay, so the person who practices slander seeks to destroy the reputation of another in order to better their own standing. That's what slander does. The person who envies not only feels a desire for that which others have, but they inwardly rejoice when that other person loses it. It's very, very bitter. Those people who are hypocrites, they lie to those who actually they should be closest to for the purpose of puffing themselves up in the eyes of others, and so on it goes. But, you know, Peter says that these things have no place in the church. They really don't. In the community of living hope, they have no place. We need to be really careful to rid ourselves of their practice. Okay, now, full disclosure, by God's kindness and grace, I do not think that we at Oldfield Park Baptist Church have a systematic problem with these things. We strive to be welcoming and to love one another sincerely. It's something that Katie, the girls and I have been on the receiving end of these last few years, and we're so grateful to God for it. But all of us are human, which means, you know, we are broken sinners, and each of us will at times be tempted to all of these vices at some point. And when we are, we should remember this call from Peter to live out our already holy status so that we can be useful for God's holy purpose to love one another. Because imagine, just for a minute, imagine the type of place that church would be if we did this. If we didn't seek our own gain, but saw other people's good instead. If we loved each other sincerely in this way, church would be a place of pure honesty where we could share our successes and our sins, the grace we receive, the burdens that we carry without fear of rumour flying around. Church would be a place where we felt we could honestly share with others our struggles, the struggles that we face in terms of faith and doubt, but also the struggles that we face just on day-to-day living. Church would be a place where we could be truly known by others and be secure at the knowledge that they would love us still. We would be able to be content with what we have, and we would be able to rejoice with others when they have more. And we would also be able to provide for those who are in need without judging them or expecting anything in return. This sort of space just doesn't exist outside the church. It might do in theory, but I have never experienced anything like it outside of a church context. Imagine that sort of holy community. Who wouldn't want to be part of that? And as we'll see as we unpack this letter more and more and more throughout the coming months, it's this visible, sincere, loving one another, this living out our holy purpose, that will make the world question itself and inquire about our hope. Peter says in chapter 2, verse 12, that we should live such good lives among the pagans that though they accuse you of doing wrong, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day he visits us. So living as a holy community would be a major part of our witness, bringing people into the community of God's people, into fellowship with God through Jesus. So as I conclude, let me ask you, what struck you from this passage? Is it your holy status? Because if you were worried about how to make yourself holy, just remember, you already are holy. You are purified by believing the truth, that living hope in the resurrection. That's, you are holy. Have you been struck thinking about your holy purpose? Were you unsure before about what your purpose was in life? Well, start by loving your brothers and sisters in Christ. Yes, even us awkward and difficult ones. Love us sincerely from the heart and let God work through you in their lives. Or maybe you've been struck by the thought of being part of a holy community. Well, let's start by rooting out any malice, slander, hypocrisy, deceit and envy amongst ourselves. Let's love each other in Christ as we should and allow God to use this as the start of our witness to the people in the area around us. Let's remember, surgical tools, right, they're only as good as the surgeon that wields them. And if we are the tools, well, God is the surgeon. We are holy, set apart for God's purposes and plans, and he will work through us to fulfil his good, pure and perfect plans in the world. There is no greater surgeon. So let's turn to him in prayer and ask him to do so. Okay, let's pray. Father, we thank you for Jesus, our great desire and our living hope. Thank you that through him we have a holy status, that even we have been purified and set apart for your purposes. Lord, please help us to love one another sincerely. There may be some of us this morning who need you to move in us, to make us brave to love others. There may be some of us who need reassurance of our holy standing before you, Lord. Wherever our hearts are, please, Lord, be at work in us. Encourage us for the purpose of being a holy community here in Oldfield Park. We pray that as we seek to obey you by loving each other, that we would be a welcoming and loving place, a holy community who are intriguing in our honesty and support and love for all its members. We ask that those around us would see you at work here and seek you for themselves. May you be glorified in us as we seek to live for you. Amen.
Just